Okay, could I encourage those leaving the public gallery to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible, as we are resuming business with a member's business debate on motion 7686 in the name of Pauline McNeill on supporting taxi drivers. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak button now or as soon as possible. And I call on Pauline McNeill to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Follow that as they say. I don't apologise for bringing people back down to earth, and thanks for staying. Because it's time to stand up for taxi drivers across the country. Taxis are a vital part of our public transport system. The taxi sector has become more vital in recent years due to unreliable train services and bus services, which I hope will get better through the years. This is actually my very first members' debate this session, and I chose to make it about the plight of taxi drivers because this industry needs our focus right now and immediate action. I, along with many of my Scottish Labour colleagues, will speak today about the clear support and of our demands. And today I stand in support of Glasgow taxi drivers in particular, as a Glasgow member, to highlight the contribution that taxi drivers make to the economy, its connectivity and the cultural life of Glasgow. Taxi drivers play a vital role in our public transport system. They plug the gaps left by unreliable train services, bus services, and they cover the times of the days where other forms of transport are not running. I've been working with taxi drivers in the last Parliament and in this Parliament, as many of you have, but also lobbying Glasgow City Council and the current Finance Secretary, Kate Forbes, on their behalf, because I believe they have been neglected during the pandemic, and I believe that they are being neglected now. Their concerns about the low emission zones being introduced in Glasgow, I can't speak for other cities, so far have been ignored. Glasgow taxi drivers have said they do support the principle of the LEZ zone, but all they've asked for is a short delay of a year to give them time to comply with the scheme. And even then, if that was to happen, it will not be enough for many. Black cabs in particular has been an iconic feature of Glasgow city centre. I don't understand why any administration seemingly would go out their way to ignore this important fact. So we know that around 1,000 cabs of the fleet, 1,420, are not Euro 6 compliant. So that is 1,000 taxi drivers at the moment who cannot enter the LEZ zone in Glasgow. So you can already begin to see the extent of the problem. So whilst 200 cabs have been given an extra 12 months, it leaves the rest of the taxi sector having to find thousands of pounds they simply don't have, obviously in a cost of living crisis. So the worry is that many will actually leave the trade and will be replaced. The high cost for new electric vehicles is approximately £60,000, with an average age of a cab driver, believe it or not, nearly 60 years old. So the finance options for a new vehicle is not really a viable solution for many. So due to the global supply chain shortages, the second-hand market is also sparse at present, meaning there's a significant lack of options for compliance. I mean, you can see there's layers and layers of problems here. The LEZ zone will have a devastating impact on traders, taxi drivers and low-income and older drivers unable to buy new cars. Yes, I'll give
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to my colleague giving way. And one of the services that taxis do bring with regards to our young people is in transport of particular groups of young people to and from school. And without an adequate replacement to that, those young people are going to lose out on their education. There is only a short pause being asked by taxi drivers. And wouldn't it be realistic for the expectation of that education delivery that both the Scottish Government and in particular Glasgow Council meet that?
Pauline McNeill.
I thank Martin Whitfield for that intervention. I could not agree more. There's so many dimensions to this impacting on the Scottish economy and the way people get to school and the way people get to their work, and young people in particular. And Stephen Grant of the Trade Union Unite, Glasgow cab branch, said it will have a devastating impact on the trade, which is why they'd called for all cabs to have a delay at least till June 2024 in relation to the LEZ zone. So I support Unite's call for a pause on the LEZ zone and for taxi drivers, and I hope the government is listening to those cab drivers working day in and day out in our city. I hope the other members will address what's happening in other cities, but if you'd forgive me, I'll only focus a bit on Glasgow. Glasgow City Council must work with those drivers, as they haven't done up to now, to allow time to source compliant vehicles. Taxi drivers have been crying out for support due to getting inadequate grant support and the unfairness of restrictions affecting busy town centres. So we need a new deal for the taxi trade, and we need a strategy that recognises the importance of taxis to our economy. Glasgow noted that the nighttime economy in its 2020 city centre strategy aimed at ensuring Glasgow remains one of the top city centres and urban tourism destinations. And research has revealed that the nighttime economy between the hours of 6 p.m. and 6 a.m. generates £2.6 billion per annum for the city, supporting 16,500 full-time jobs, whilst the retail sector generates more than £3.3 billion and supports 17,000 full-time jobs. So the impact on the economy is extraordinary, and I'm sure it's the case in other cities. Combined employment from the sector represents over a fifth of city centre working population. Many of these workers in the city centre rely on taxis to bring them home after their shift, and people who work during the evening and early hours in nightclubs and bars will be severely affected, as they will now have to rely on public transport. I mean, I'm sure other members like me have had parents contact them, in fact, maybe parents in your own family, who know that many people have just simply walked home from the city centre because they can't get a taxi. And that is quite a frightening thought for a parent, thinking that you're child or young person is walking quite long distances to get home because they simply cannot get home any other way. The lack of availability of taxis will greatly affect those who work in the city centre during the evenings and busy weekends. So we must recognise the vital role that it plays in a city like Glasgow. I mean, I'm in the city centre quite late at night. Those of you who know, I'm a musician and I play in Glasgow city centre. I can already see that people start to leave the pubs earlier than they used to, and that's simply because they're worried about getting home. So again, there's obviously other issues to do with public transport, but getting a properly viable taxi trade is absolutely vital to getting the city centre back into its former patterns. So taxi drivers provide a safe transport option for women. I know this was addressed in the debate a few weeks ago, and the vulnerable people at night provides an important service for people with mobility issues, and a topic that will be covered by my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy. Glasgow Taxis have demonstrated an ongoing commitment to city safety through its commitment to the Safe Taxi Scheme, and the safety initiative ensures that if a Glasgow student is alone and they found themselves stuck in a night out with no money, they can still make it back home safely by using their student card as payment in emergency situations. Too often students can end up in potentially unsafe circumstances and not being able to get home. So Glasgow Taxis are to be commended for their commitment to getting young students home safe at night. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, as a regional member, I have to say that I watched the SNP administration in Glasgow set up a policy which could literally wipe out black cab trade in the city, with no response so far as to how we're going to see our way through this. Taxi drivers across Scotland who've lobbied this Parliament only recently were given grant funding to compensate for the impact of the restrictions during COVID. But some local authorities paid it more than once, but Glasgow did not. Glasgow paid once out of the fund, and there seems to be no realisation that Glasgow, being the most locked down city in the UK, that they would have such a devastating impact, and we're still feeling it now. And that is why I brought this debate to Parliament today. We must learn the lessons from the restrictions that we imposed, and if hopefully this will never happen again, a pandemic of this kind. But we must learn that you have to support trades like this in the period in between while they try to recover. Presiding Officer, I'm glad I've had this chance to speak in this debate tonight. I look forward to other contributions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms McNeill. I now call David Torrance to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Paul McNeill for securing this debate on such an important topic. Provisions of taxi is a vital part of our transport system, and I very much share the concerns of taxi drivers across the country about the challenges facing the sector as a result of COVID-19 pandemic, Brexit and the cost of living crisis. Taxi drivers provide an invaluable service to key workers and vulnerable people throughout lockdown and beyond. And I was very much welcome the £57 million in support that was offered to taxi drivers by the Scottish Government in the immediate aftermath of the pandemic. As Deputy Convener of the Citizens Participation in Public Petitions Committee, I have had the privilege of hearing evidence from taxi drivers and representatives across the sector on the further support that is needed for industry to fully recover from the effects of the pandemic. The committee has listened carefully to the proposals set out in the petition submitted by on behalf of Unite, and I very much welcome the announcement from Transport Scotland that it will explore with trade unions and other stakeholders the best forum for engagement with the taxi trade and to address any ongoing concerns. As the motion recognises, support for the taxi drivers is not just a transportation issue, it is of culture, social, economic and environmental concern, and I welcome the Scottish Government's cross-sectoral approach in treating it as such. For example, I am proud of the Scottish Government's ambitious plans to prioritise the just transition to net zero by offering low emission zones retrofit grants available to taxi drivers to help support the shift to lower emissions and greener vehicles. And I will acknowledge that this has been difficult for taxi drivers in Glasgow to do. The Citizens' Participation in Public Petitions Committee has seen evidence from the taxi sector regarding potential challenges that reductions of low emission zones may present to taxi drivers, and I am reassured to know that our Transport Minister is working closely with taxi representatives and unions to discuss the matter further. Fife is one of the most heavily populated local authorities in Scotland, and although we benefit from a range of rail and bus services, taxis are an essential part of our transport chain, contributing significantly to access to Fife's array of hospitality, tourism, nightlife, manufacturing industries and outdoor activities. With a summer season on its way, it is essential that taxi drivers feel supported and valued as major players in our local economy, as they are in Glasgow. Presiding officer, I am incredibly sympathetic about the financial pressures facing taxi drivers at this time, and we cannot ignore the glaring obvious pitfalls of the UK Government's recent spring budget. Households across the country, including those of taxi drivers, are facing the biggest fall in living standards on record, and the families are seeing their incomes devastated by a cost of living crisis. I am confident that the Scottish Government is using its limited powers and resources to address the cost of living crisis, and while the Chancellor's increase in funding to the Scottish Government is welcome, it is nowhere near adequate to deal with significant fiscal challenges as a direct result of the economic chaos caused by Westminster facing the Scottish Government and the Scottish local authorities. I know it will be a huge disappointment for the taxi industry that the Chancellor missed a vital opportunity to implement real support and to grant the levers to the Scottish Government that are necessary to implement meaningful support to taxi drivers. The Chancellor's measures will also do little to mitigate the damage of Brexit, which has intensified the driver shortage crisis in Scotland. The impact on labour shortages has been felt across Scotland, including in many owned in my constituency. In evidence submitted to the Citizens' Participation in Public Petitions Committee, Fife Council raised concerns that taxi operators are constantly having to turn down hires on a regular basis due to a shortage of drivers across Fife. The issue has been exacerbated by a massive decrease in taxi driver numbers, according to the Scottish Taxi Federation. Driver numbers have been devastated by COVID, with many deciding not to return to the taxi trade in favour of other employment oppositions. I would like to conclude by giving immense thanks to taxi drivers in my constituency and across the country for continuing to provide the people of Scotland with fast, safe, reliable and economical transport. It is clear that there are many pressures facing the industry. The aftermath of the pandemic, Brexit and the cost of living crisis and the Citizens' Participation in Public Petitions Committee will continue to take the evidence from the sector in order to advise the Scottish Government on the best way forward.
Thank you, Mr Sorens. I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Graeme Simpson for up to 4 minutes. Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank my friend and colleague, Polly McNeill, for bringing this debate to the Chamber and for all the work that she has done to support the taxi trade, including in Glasgow. Presiding Officer, I'd like to use my time to talk mainly about how important taxis are to me and other disabled people. As a disabled woman, most types of public transport in Glasgow simply aren't accessible to me. I can't use the subway as most of the platforms have steps and no lifts, and even when I could get to the platform, the current trains are not accessible for wheelchair users. Buses have a one wheelchair rule, meaning I can't travel on them if there is already a wheelchair user on board, or indeed a pram, and I can't travel on buses with my partner, who is also a wheelchair user. I told this chamber of this story earlier this month that this not only hampers my ability to get around, but it is also dangerous. And I told the chamber of the experience I had when I had to travel on my own at night and was followed home doing so. And, Presiding Officer, it's not even ambulances are fully accessible in the city of Glasgow. And when I fell last year, there was no space to take my wheelchair with me or for my husband to come. It was taxis that stepped up. So, Presiding Officer, this is crucial for disabled people and also women, as I'll come on to. And I'm not alone. Research carried out by Transport Scotland shows that disabled people are less likely to have a driving licence than non-disabled people, and they're less likely to have a car available to their household than non-disabled people. Having public transport that is accessible is, of course, vital for us to travel around freely and participate in society in the same way our peers do, but we are not there yet. For most disabled people, myself included, taxis are by far the easiest and most accessible form of public transport available to us. Disabled people make twice as many taxi journeys a year compared to non-disabled people. Right across the region, Glasgow Black Cabs are helping disabled people to get to school, go to work, see friends, access hospital appointments, and, as I've said, even provide them with an emergency service. And taxis are not only key to disabled people. They also provide a safe form of transport for many others, including women, particularly when travelling at home at night. They are really fundamental to so many people, which is why I'm deeply concerned about the impact the low emission zone in Glasgow is going to have on the trade. We are already seeing problems. People, as my colleague Paul McNeill have spoken of, walking home or leaving early. Disabled people not getting to work on time because of delays caused by fewer cabs available. And trouble getting disabled children, as my colleague Martin Whitfield has spoken of, to school. All because there are fewer drivers in the trade already. The situation is serious. Whilst I support action to address climate change, including low emission zones, our transition to net zero must be just. And to be just, that transition must protect jobs and equality. As it currently stands, I believe the implementation of the low emission zone in Glasgow will fall far short of this standard. I first met with representatives of the Glasgow Unite cab section in February 2022, after they had launched their Stop the Black Cab Blackout campaign the weekend before. Not long after this, I met Glasgow Taxis, the largest supplier of licensed taxis in Glasgow, with an entirely wheelchair-accessible fleet. They all told me the same thing, that without urgent action, the low emission zone will be devastating for the public taxi trade and drivers in it in Glasgow. And my colleague Polly McNeill has, of course, set out in detail the stark reality that faces those drivers. We are in a cost of living crisis. Many drivers are already struggling to make ends meet, and we've heard that already in this debate. Without action from the government, they cannot afford to meet the requirements. And, Presiding Officer, it's not just funding that's the only factor. As we've heard, a decline in the supply of parts is also affecting the industry and delaying retrofitting work too. Other authorities, such as Edinburgh and Aberdeen, have recognised how hard this is for taxis and rightly have extended the implementation of their low emission zones until 2024. However, Glasgow City Council is refusing to do this for so many taxi drivers. They're not opposed to action to tackle emissions. They are simply asking for more time and financial help so that they have a fair chance of meeting the requirements of the low emission zone. Job losses and unemployment are already a significant problem in Glasgow. What thought has been given to these drivers for whom many reskilling simply isn't an option? What are they to do? And what are disabled people and women and everybody else who relies so heavily on taxis meant to do when so many go off the road? Presiding Officer, since the moment I learnt about the devastating impact Glasgow's low emission zone could have on the black cab trade there, I've not stopped fighting to save them. We cannot let Glasgow's accessible black cab trade die. We cannot leave thousands of drivers without jobs, and we cannot leave women and disabled people without safe and accessible transport. So in closing, I ask, will the Minister, in her statement, please take action and set out how she will take action to give Glasgow's black cab taxi trade a fighting chance at survival. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Paul Sweeney, up to 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Pauline McNeill for bringing this debate to the Chamber? It's really, really important. I was driving into Glasgow earlier this week, and I saw a rather depressing sight. As I drove in along the M77, huge signs, massive signs by the roadside advertising the fact that the low emission zone is coming into effect in June. So it seems there's no turning back. This is going to happen. Now, Pauline McNeill has rightly described taxis as part of our public transport system. That's how we need to view them, particularly in a city like Glasgow. Edinburgh's the same. But in Glasgow, we've kind of become used to having Lots of black cabs around. You bet you're just able to stick out your thumb and get a black cab. There have been so many black cabs that actually, when my wife and I got married a long time ago, we invited guests just to stick out their thumb and get a black cab and go to where we're having our celebratory meal. That's how good they've been. Now, I fear, as Pauline McNeill fears, and members of the Unite the Union who I've been working with, that we're going to lose hundreds of black cabs in that city. And the effect of that, of course, as people have pointed out, is that this will affect women, and I know the Minister feels that very strongly, and as Pam Duncan-Glancy has said, disabled people, who need to get home, particularly late at night. Black cabs provide a service that cannot be provided by anyone else. Now, Glasgow City Council knows the issues. They should understand the trade. Let me explain the black cab trade to you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In Glasgow, in fact, across Scotland, our taxi drivers tend to buy second-hand vehicles. And a lot of them come from the London market. So they have to wait for those second-hand vehicles to appear in the second-hand market. And that's really why they're asking for extra time, because those vehicles just aren't there yet. So we face a cliff edge in June, or Glasgow faces a cliff edge, where we will lose taxis. We will just lose taxis. It's a fact. And the city is going to suffer. And not just the city, people who live near the city, who go into the city, people who live in places like East Kilbride, where I'm from, you know that. Glasgow is a regional centre, so it's not just for the people of Glasgow, it's for the people who come into Glasgow. Glasgow City Council can, and it is going to introduce the low emission zone, but it can still be flexible. It could exempt taxis for the year that they're asking for. It's not too late. So I'd merely say to the Minister, if she's speaking to her colleagues in Glasgow City Council, the low emission zone meter can be paused and should be paused, and it's for the benefit of people like women, disabled people, children. It's for the benefit of the public who need taxis. It's also for the benefit of the taxi trade, and it makes sense. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Simpson. I now call Paul Sweeney to be followed by Faisal Choudhury for around 4 minutes. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I want to congratulate my Glasgow colleague, Pauline McNeill, for bringing this important motion for members' business to debate in the Chamber today, and I hope that the Minister has heard the words of members across the Chamber in this critical issue facing taxi drivers across our city and across Scotland more widely. And I speak from some experience. My dad is a taxi driver, someone in his 60s who drives a taxi in Glasgow, and he did that because he was made redundant from the shipyards, and it was a way of him being able to earn a stable income and have some more control over his life after suffering from the impact of deindustrialisation in a city like Glasgow. And that's the story of many taxi drivers in our city who do it because it offered a flexible and stable income. And they're all people, by and large, who are of that generation of maybe in their 50s and 60s. They aren't the sort of people who are prepared or able to take on tens of thousands of pounds of debt to finance the purchase of a new vehicle. Nor would they want to, because they're not in a point in their careers where that makes sense. So that's where we're in this real wicked problem of a crunch where a new technology is coming and they're phasing out of internal combustion engine vehicles. The new second-hand market isn't established and there isn't the financial wherewithal or products available to facilitate that transition in a meaningful way. And then to add insult to that injury, the council are, in Glasgow certainly are pig-headedly pressing ahead with the blunt implementation of a low emission zone and have not paid heed to the valid concerns that have been raised from taxi drivers. And I know that taxi drivers are not Luddites, they're not anti-environmental improvement. They want to go with the grain, but they need to be given a fair deal, in the same way that the bus companies have been given a fair deal to renew their fleets with substantial and very generous public subsidies, and along with the large capital raising capacity of bus companies to renew their fleets. Taxi drivers, who are often self-employed, often don't have the means to raise capital, are at a point in their lives where they aren't able to get that kind of finance, need that extra support from the government. Otherwise, the public good provided by taxis, as described so eloquently by colleagues across the chamber today, whether it was in the educational aspects, disability access, or indeed supporting our nighttime economy, will suffer. We will all suffer, because we all have skin in the game of having a thriving taxi industry. And in the context in Glasgow whereby we have a public transport system that is basically non-existent after 11:30 at night until 6 a.m. in the morning, they're all the more critical. And we've heard about the safety implications of them not being available, both for workers and those who participate in our nighttime economy as consumers. We're hearing the chilling effect it's having on our wider economy, worth billions of pounds a year. And Glasgow is a city with a very low city centre residential population, which relies disproportionately on people travelling from the suburbs, as Mr Simpson described, from places like East Kilbride, from the outer suburbs of the city, to participate in the hospitality venues in the city centre. And they are not going to be able to do that. It's changing behaviour, and that has an effect on revenues, and it results in business failure. So it has a compounding effect if we don't address this firsthand. And we have lots of opportunities. I mean, certainly we've heard pretty damaging figures of the licences in Glasgow down 15% since 2019. And when you add in shift drivers, I would argue that the actual availability of taxis on the road are probably a factor of twice as big. So we're actually seeing potentially up to a third to half of the available taxis on the streets of Glasgow at any one time down. That's a pretty horrific number. And I know from personal experience, coming off the train at Queen Street in the evenings, how difficult it is to get a taxi, particularly midweek. So it is a major issue, but there are solutions out there. Greater Manchester's Clean Air Plan shows it is possible to take action to improve air quality without harming the taxi trade. And their Clean Air Plan includes proposals for a Greater Manchester-wide Clean Air Zone, and that's been introduced alongside a total of £21.4 million in funding for the taxi industry to renew their fleets and to allow for that transition to more compliant vehicles. And we can do that with a major manufacturer in the city, such as Ally Vehicles, the UK's largest taxi manufacturer in Glasgow, employing 600 people. There's a joined-up approach. Work with the industry to develop a product that is practical and can work better than the ones that have been done so far. The switched-on taxi loan scheme just does not work. It's not got the scale needed, and it doesn't address those issues. So I would appeal to the Minister to look at this again and work with the Council and with industry to solve this problem, because there is a willingness to do it. We just need to get the right pieces in place to make it work.
Thank you very much, Mr Sweeney. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Faisal Chowdhury, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thank you to my colleague, Pauline McLean, for highlighting this issue in the Chamber. Today's motion highlights the important service that taxi drivers provide for the transport sector. They provide a means of transport for those unable to take public transport, as well as safe route home from thousands of people who are not comfortable with using public transport on their own or late at night. They also provide a means of transport of those physically unable to take buses, trains or trams, and in places where public transport is not easily accessible. I echo the words of the motion today in emphasising the support that Scotland Taxi Services provide to the hospitality and event sector. As Shadow Minister for Culture, I recognise the important role the taxi drivers play in the revitalising the cultural sector in both Glasgow and Edinburgh after a difficult few years for the industry. Lots of the industries felt that the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic, but this unprecedented times forced many taxi drivers to give up their profession entirely. Throughout the pandemic, taxi drivers struggled with severely reduced passengers number and restrictions that made it very difficult for them to work full-time. They did not receive enough support from the Scottish Government, and as many taxi drivers are self-employed, they were forced to find other means of income. Many did not return to the profession after the pandemic. This has further exacerbated the shortage of taxi drivers in cities across Scotland. The Scottish Government moved towards low emission zone will further exacerbate the challenges faced by taxi drivers and will make their jobs even more difficult. It is clear that not enough is being done to support taxi drivers throughout this transition. The Scottish Government must reinforce their value of taxi drivers and do more to support their important job. As I have already mentioned, taxi drivers provide a safe route home for those who cannot travel on public transport or feel unsafe when walking home alone. As I highlighted in my speech in International Women's Day, taxi drivers often provide this vital service while dealing with mass amount of unruly, aggressive and intoxicated passengers. Many of my constituents who are taxi drivers have told me of the difficulty of having to deal with stressful and complicated situations by themselves, as many are self-employed. More should be done to ensure that taxi drivers are met with the same level of respect as the other public service provider. The Scottish Government must facilitate action towards supporting taxi drivers and the valuable contribution they make to the nighttime economy and culture industry. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call on Jenny Eagle-Ruth to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by congratulating Polly McNeill on securing this afternoon's important members' debate? And Polly McNeill was absolutely right to speak to the vital importance of our taxi drivers to the Scottish economy. I've listened very carefully, Presiding Officer, to the contributions from members this afternoon, and I really do appreciate the issues and concerns that have been raised by members. I'll try to respond to each in turn. I'm just conscious, Presiding Officer, that next week I might not be the Transport Minister, and I wanted today to put on record my commitment to engaging throughout my time in post as Transport Minister directly with our trade unions, but particularly with our trade unions in relation to this issue, and in fact I met with them on this matter only last week. Now, as we were hearing in the previous session, of course, exactly 3 years ago today, the country entered a national lockdown. Stay at home was the mantra. Saving lives was the imperative. And of course, lockdown restrictions, as we've heard today and this afternoon, cut us off from family and friends. But they also necessitated that certain businesses had to stop trading, cafes, shops ceased to trade. And indeed, of course, the Scottish economy contracted during the first few months of lockdown by 20%. Now, the Scottish Government did provide support, making available around £4.4 billion in grants and non-domestic rates relief. That helped to save many businesses. It acted like a lifetime. But as I know, we've heard from Polly McNeill and from others today, it was a really, really challenging time for our taxi industry. And we also know, as we've heard from members this afternoon, that demand for taxi drivers plummeted, of course, throughout the pandemic. Operators reporting around an 80% drop in bookings. And I think we heard some of that from Faisal Chowdhury's contribution, because many drivers, of course, chose to leave the profession, as I think we also heard from Mr. Sweeney. And those who did stay reported huge reductions in relation to their income. Now, there was specific funding provided by the Scottish Government, I think, as I mentioned, to the taxi trade through the Taxi and Private Hire Driver Support Fund and latterly through the Taxi and Private Hire Vehicle Driver and Operator Support Fund. But as we heard from Polly McNeill, the importance of the nighttime economy, particularly during our recovery from the pandemic, cannot be underestimated. And Faisal Chowdhury will know my particular interest in this, given my previous ministerial responsibilities as Minister for Culture. It's really important that we have a holistic approach in government that recognises the challenge, particularly that's faced by our nighttime economy at the current time. And I think, too, particularly in Glasgow, where it's such a thriving industry, and I have to put on record, of course, being half Glaswegian, that I lived in Glasgow, I think, for nearly a quarter of my life as a student, and then latterly when I was working. So I very much recognise the vibrancy of that nighttime economy and the need to support it adequately, and particularly our taxi drivers who work in that environment. Now, as I've put on record, I've previously met with the STUC, I've met with Unite, and I also, at the end of last year, met with the Scottish Association of Private Hire Operators to talk about this issue and others more broadly. There were a number of challenges faced by the sector at the current time. I think we heard from David Torrance about some of the challenges in relation to driver shortages, which have been exacerbated to some extent by Brexit. It's also true to say, as I mentioned, that some have just simply chose to walk away from the trade completely. I do want to make mention of the importance of properly licensed taxis. And as I think we heard from Graeme Simpson and from others, women and minorities often depend on our taxi trade to get home safely. Absolutely.
Polly McNeill.
Given way, before you move on to that, I just wanted to highlight, in fact, Paul Sweeney talked about this, and it has made this important to me actually in conversation. I think it's a good one, which is that would you have any influence or in your post now, and I wish you well on that in the future, to talk about how local authorities like Glasgow could sit down with companies and other parts of the sector and bring them a bit more together to see. Well, I've called for a new deal for taxi drivers. You know, Glasgow was the most locked down city, and that's part of the issue. But obviously, the city's not returning to what it was. It kind of speaks to maybe, and I know you're talking to lots of people, that a deal encompassing companies that can bring something to the table might be something that you could encourage authorities like Glasgow to do.
Comments through the Chair and Minister.
I'm more than happy to consider the Member's suggestion, and particularly in relation to licensing. I've been in discussion with officials on this point this morning, actually, and of course responsibility for licensing actually sits with another Minister within Scottish Government. But I think there is a requirement for more commonality in respect to how that's administered across local authorities to ensure there's more of a level playing ground, if that is the point the Member was alluding to. I recognise that very much so. Yes, absolutely.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Minister, for giving me. Just to develop that point about taxi renewal and a product available. So the switched-on taxi loan scheme isn't attractive to older drivers for the reasons that I mentioned in my speech, but perhaps working with a manufacturer like Allied could develop a PCP-type scheme or a patient leasing scheme that might be attractive to drivers and then could allow them to transition without the huge upfront capital costs of buying a vehicle that comes to be £60,000 to £100,000.
Minister,
I think the Member makes a very important and valid point. I'm not going to give my commitment on the record today for reasons he will well understand. However, I think that is a very persuasive argument in relation to how that could be administered in the future. And of course, I think, as we've heard from David Torrance, Transport Scotland, irrespective of who holds this position next week, will continue to engage with the Transport Minister on this matter directly with local authorities, because it is an ongoing challenge. Now, we heard from Pam Duncan-Glancy, who spoke of some of the challenges in relation to accessibility on our wider public transport network. She will know I'm very live to those issues through wider work we're undertaking in relation to women's safety, but there is a huge challenge here. And of course, taxis play a vital role in relation to that accessibility point. And there's more that we will need to do as a government on that matter, irrespective of who holds this post in the future. Now, I don't think there's been a debate today, Presiding Officer, about the need for low-emission zones. There was a question raised at First Minister's questions relating to climate change and how we're going to aspire to reach our ambitious climate change targets. And undoubtedly, low-emission zones have a role to play in that regard. And actually, earlier this week, there was data published that looked at those Scots living in some of the poorest area in Scotland being much more likely to die from lung conditions. And I know that Asthma and Lung UK are calling on governments, including this government, to do more to tackle health inequalities by improving air quality. And low-emission zones have a key role to play, I think, in that endeavour. Now, we've spoken today at great length about some of the specifics in relation to Glasgow City Council. And obviously, as Minister, these decisions are for Glasgow City Council, but I will say and put on the record that I have discussed this matter with Glasgow City Council, most recently only 2 weeks ago, I think. Now, Glasgow City Council, of course, are responsible for granting exemptions. I know there is also, and I think I've discussed this matter with Pam Duncan-Glancy in a previous parliamentary exchange, there is a specific challenge in Glasgow because of the age of the fleet at the current time, where they have a much, much older fleet than other parts of the country. That is in part due to the Council's licensing conditions historically having been more lax than in other parts of the country. Now, I know that taxi... Absolutely.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Minister for taking the intervention. On that basis, would the Minister agree that, therefore, there is a case to be made that Glasgow would, therefore, delay for taxi drivers the implementation of the low-emission zone in order for them to put in place things like what my colleague Paul Sweeney has suggested and interventions that Polly McNeill has suggested and others?
Minister.
Well, obviously, this is a matter for the City Council, but I hear the Member's point, and I just want to come on to the position of Glasgow City Council. It is, of course, one for them to outline, but I recognise that taxi operators and the unions have been engaging with the local authority. I think very recently, Glasgow have confirmed there will be an additional year for those that can't be retrofitted, and the position for others is simply a requirement to demonstrate that they have signed up to the process of applying for funding. Now, I understand the trade and guidance is about to be issued on this early next week, but, of course, that is a matter for Glasgow City Council. Certainly, I did discuss that very matter that the Member has raised with the unions only last week. Presiding Officer, I'm conscious of time, and we have discussed at length some of the issues in today's, this afternoon rather, debate in relation to the importance of low emission zones. and I recognise the views of members, particularly in relation to some of the challenges that are being experienced in Glasgow. I commit as Transport Minister to work with our trade unions to reach a resolution and with the City Council. I recognise the City Council are taking action. Of course, the taxi trade plays a really vital role in Scotland. It gets people from A to B, it protects vulnerable passengers, as we've heard, and it provides mobility to those who otherwise might not be able to access key services. The Government has absolutely committed to improving our air quality through the rollout of low emission zones. We will continue this important work, and we will also continue to support the taxi and private hire trade. They make a really vital contribution to Scottish society, and we will continue that support to the sector as best we can, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2:30.